guest today was part of the phenomenon of chart-topping bands that came out of Sheffield in the early 80s. They formed when he was a self-professed opinionated teen. He was running a fanzine called Modern Drugs, based around the concept that music and art are actually the new drugs. After interviewing a group, Vice Versa, for his publication, not only did he join them, he changed their name, their musical direction, and by the fall of 1982, had signed a record contract, and, as they say, the rest is history. Their first single, Tears Are Not Enough, made ripples in the charts, but it was their next two singles, Poison Arrow and The Look of Love, which would turn them into overnight pop icons. Peaking at 14 and 12 in the Irish charts, respectively, the song spent 11 weeks overall in the chart and paved the way for their debut album, The Lexicon of Love, widely considered one of the best albums of the decade. One of the most prolific bands of the era, they recorded a very impressive 6 studio albums between 82 and 91, released a greatest hits compilation, and in total enjoyed 8 Irish top 30 hits, 10 in the UK, 5 top 40 hits in the US in that period. After a brief hiatus in the early 90s, the name was then resurrected by my guest in 97, and he has gone on to record another 3 studio albums, including the follow-up to their most iconic record, namely Lexicon of Love 2 in 2016, which became their most successful album in decades. He tours extensively, collaborates with numerous other artists. He's an honorary doctor of music at Sheffield University. He won't ever shake the association to one famed gold lamé suit. Ladies and gentlemen, it's the absolutely gorgeous Mr. Martin Fry from ABC. Hello.
Thank you for that wonderful, wonderful, wonderful build-up. I hope I can justify the price of admission. Yes. Hello.
Well, you've had a distinguished career. We want to make sure we cover, you know, a little bit about your background for our for our audience. You're very loved in Ireland, so people want to know more. If it's okay, they've sent in some questions for us to ask you. So
fine.
Lovely.
I would like to answer them. Thank you very much.
Super. So in the 80s, there was quite a clique of Sheffield bands in the charts. Obviously yourself, Human League and others. Was there competition, friendly rivalry sort of geographically for you?
In Sheffield, it was great being a bohemian musician, you know, wandering around with your doll money in your back pocket, dreaming about creating a rock and roll band. There was Cabaret Voltaire, Human League, Clock DVA, Artery, I'm So Hollow, Vice Versa, the band I joined, Def Leppard. Mm. And I used to run into the guys from Saxon who were really helpful. Drummer in Saxon was really friendly to us. Even though we were kind of a different genre of music, you know, we were into our electronic sort of pop. There was a kind of community amongst all those guys in Sheffield, I think, yeah. But of course, there was a fierce rivalry because, as everybody knows, when you're in that sort of seminal stage, somebody gets a record deal and you think, oh, maybe they've got the deal for the whole city. You know, I'm sure it's the same in Dublin, Belfast, Manchester, Birmingham. Yeah. You kind of want to be there. But the Human League kind of took off. Really big. They had a record deal with Virgin, made a couple of albums just before Don't You Want Me Baby. So in a way that kind of inspires you to greater things. Yeah. And I hope we've inspired other bands too, you know.
It's
a kind of funny thing. And at Top of the Pops, a couple of years after forming, I used to think it was really, really competitive. Only one band can get to number one. So, you know.
It is. Of course, it is.
I'd like to think it's mellowed a bit now, but we shall see on the day when we all perform together.
Yeah, well, I have to say, I think that's probably valid advice for a band in any era that, you know, just because somebody got the ticket for the train, it doesn't mean there's not another train coming along the platform. So, you know.
There's always a train. There's always another train.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I used to hitchhike a lot back then. Yeah. There's
always hitchhike. Another. Get there any way you can.
Get there.
Super.
If you beat your own rhythm, you know, and if you're kind of, what is it what they say, 2% inspiration, 98% perspiration. Yeah. You know what I mean?
And authenticity, sticking to your furrow, you know, ploughing your furrow, not letting other people keep trying to drag you off course.
Yeah.
So you ran a fanzine called Modern Drugs in the 70s. Yeah. Now, there is an old issue on Tumblr. You had quite a lot to say about pop culture. In issue
Absolutely.
One...
Pop culture is very important.
Oh, it is.
It's very important.
But in issue one, I think you said, Top of the Pops shouldn't be planned, but it is. Did that remark come back to haunt you?
It was really bland. It was just Scylla and Cliff until Duran showed up and Spandau Ballet and ABC and Depeche Mode and Dexys, Human League, all those great bands from the early 80s, Eurythmics, Culture Club,
Shook it up, gave it more flavour.
I think that was the... We were at the vanguard of a new age. We were kind of there trying to break into the mainstream. You know, I think that's what all those bands were trying to do. Yeah. There's only so much Shaking Stevens you can have.
He did rule. He did rule quite a lot, didn't he?
He ruled. He was king. He was king.
Absolutely.
In his feet for many years.
No. Yeah.
But, I mean, that's the beautiful thing about music. It changes. It should change all the time, every 15 seconds. Yeah. And, you know, that's what... today's all about for every new band come, every new, you know, artist coming through. They want to shake things up, don't they?
Of course they do. As a style icon and your advice for the younger generations, you said that your record company didn't understand the gold suit and they didn't understand why you insisted on wearing it. Did that kind of garner you to be a little bit more persistent with, I'm going to wear it, just because they weren't very keen?
Yeah, I mean, there's an illusion that a record company takes an artist or a band or a singer or, you know, somebody with talent and sort of tells them what to do. No. Even the boy bands, I think. I don't think that works. Or girl bands, you know. I think genuine success comes from, you know, your relationship with your audience. And as you say, that comes from some sort of authentic thing they see on, you know, in you when you're on stage or performing. So I've never... We've had some magnificent success, magnificent failures, but it was never at the advice of the record label. We'd ignore that. Yeah. And also, I think it's a really good quality to have stubbornness, where if somebody says turn right, you turn left. I think that's really important. Success and failure in the music business, because there's a million and one people tell you, oh, you know, everybody's a football manager, aren't they, you know? But, like... No, the gold suit, no, it was Elvis had one, so it made sense, you know.
Yeah.
We were an old generation looking to, in the early 80s, felt a bit sort of invisible, so I think it was all, it was either a cry for help or a kind of way of getting to your audience, you know.
Making a statement, standing
attention
out.
Seeking. Mm. Attention seeking is a big part of rock and roll, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. But have you got to have a bit of a rebel quality to survive in this industry, haven't you? So
you do. You do have to have a rebel quality because nobody's interested in the status quo. There's no point coming along going, we're just like them other 30 bands.
No one wants that.
You have to come along and say, no, we're the future of rock and roll. So I love that tradition. I hope it's going on today, I think. Yeah.
I believe you once worked in a baked bean factory. Is this true?
Actually.
And did that put you off of baked beans?
Actually, it was peas. We were involved in peas 8 hours a day. The peas would arrive at one end and they put them on a conveyor belt and dry them out, basically. It was so hot in that factory that they gave you lime juice to drink. You know, it was compulsory with salt in it. So we must have been, it was a hot place to work.
God.
And those peas went into snack pots. I'd never really ate many snack pots, but it was a great place to work in Sheffield because it was mostly musicians. That's where I met Steve Singleton, a guy that was originally in ABC all those years ago. So, yeah, you'd see a lot of maverick musicians
packing peas,
clocking on or clocking off as you came to Sheffield. So it was a kind of good place to earn some money. Yeah, definitely, no regrets.
Cool.
And I once read that I was sitting there in the Bachelors and I read that Bob Geldof had worked in a bean factory or something similar.
Like,
so that did inspire me when I was reading my Melody Maker. It did. I don't know, that's
random
true.
Random facts. Everyone loves them. So ABC is often described along with the new romantic bands, but the image and the music don't really fall into that category. More art pop meets soul, maybe. But how would you describe the style of your music?
Art pop meets soul. Yeah, I'm stealing that. We came a bit later to the party, so we weren't strictly kind of a Steve Strange kind of early Spandau sort of New Romantics. We were up in Sheffield doing our thing. But we came through the same time as Haircut 100. Duran and Spandau had already sort of established themselves. So I guess we were the kind of next generation coming through. Yeah.
So Tony has asked, you know, due to your success at the time, were you asked to play Live Aid?
Actually, Live Aid, it would have been wonderful to play Live Aid, but at the time I was hospitalised, I was very ill. So it wasn't really an option anyway, but No, I had to sit and watch that up in Sheff.
But you're still here, so that's more important.
I'm still here.
Exactly.
So, but Live Aid was a wonderful, it was a wonderful moment, wasn't it? Yeah, phenomenal.
Incredible, incredible moment to be part of that time in history, yeah. Your song When Smokey Sings was a huge hit. Do you know what Smokey Robinson made of this hit?
Yeah, I met him. We went to Holland and we did a show called Top Pop, Top of the Pops there. And they said, oh, we're there to promote When Smokey Sings. They go, all right, we got Smokey Robinson on the show.
You were like...
So I walked down the corridor and knocked on his door, you know, star with Smokey Robinson, William S. Robinson, Smokey Robinson. And I said, hello, Mr. Robinson, here's our 7-inch and 12-inch of When Smokey Sings. And about, I think he was a bit, I don't know, he graciously accepted the gift. And then I ran into him about 4 weeks later, and by then, our record and his record were in the top five in America. So we met at a TV show and he was like, he was really friendly, yeah. He sent a handwritten note to me and a handwritten note to Mark White, the other guy. We both wrote the song together and he just thanked us. He's a really cool guy, yeah. Aww. And at the bottom of the letter, it says William S. Robinson, chairman of Tamla Motown or something. At the time he was...
How cool is that?
Smokey Robinson is not only is he an incredible lyricist and melody writer, but he's still going strong, isn't he? He's got an album out today, I think. So, you know.
Amazing. Yeah. Truly amazing.
But I loved all the Motown tunes, Smokey Robinson, Marvin Gaye, you know, Stevie Wonder. Mm. That was a source, The Temptations. They were a source of inspiration. So,
yeah,
it felt right to kind of put all that into one song.
You wrote 40 tracks, we believe, for Lexicon of Love 2. How did you go about bringing that down to just the 11 tracks on the album?
Well, the more albums you make, you get kind of a little bit of slab fever, I think. You get a kind of, you can overthink things. So, and also I've not made an album for a while, so I write stuff all the time. So you write songs, but you don't always finish them. You know, you've got two verses and half a chorus or, you know, a kind of fragment of an idea. So. But there were 40 tunes, you know, 40 ideas all set up, yeah, demoed. But in the end, I think I used a couple of songs I'd written with the guy called Marcus Villa and Charlie Mole. And then I kind of used the stuff I'd just, you always like the stuff you've just done. So I wrote some stuff with Ann Dudley and, various, loads of different people, yeah. Rob Massari is a guy I like working with. He's really cool. So I don't know. It's a funny thing making an album, but they said to me at the label, if you don't finish it by February, we want to put it out. We'll put it out if you finish it by the end of February. So that was it, really. It's kind of mid-December. I'm off to Japan to do some shows. I thought, right, I better kind of...
Got to decide. Gun to the head. Get it done.
And I have to admit, it'd take me like 25 years to get around to actually doing a record like that. So I've made records in lots of different ways. So it was great to have a deadline, really. Yeah. Yeah. It kind of made me finish it. Yeah. And most musicians are lazy, aren't they? You know? Yeah. Daydreamers. We're all daydreamers.
Nothing wrong with that. Creatives. Absolutely. You worked with Trevor Horn in the first album, you know?
Yeah.
Is that something you wanted to explore for the second or?
No, Trevor's great. I saw him about a year ago in Florida. He was doing some shows there. Trevor's a fantastic producer, as everybody knows. So, yeah, it was very inspiring working with him. When we got around to make our second album, he was kind of hooked up finishing off a Yes album. So it was a question of, it would have taken a while for him to get out of that studio and come back and work with us. So we kind of ploughed on. But it would have been nice. Yeah, he's still a very creative guy. Yeah, all these years on.
Yeah,
he's got a great sense. Trevor's great because he's got a great sense of humour. Yeah. Yeah. And he doesn't really suffer fools. He kind of gets the best out of people, I think, in the studio that way. Yeah. Mm. You kind of get this impression he's getting a bit bored. So you have to come up with something, you know.
You've got to impress him.
because it won't go on the record otherwise, you know. So, oh, that was a great production skill amongst others, you know. Yeah, it was great.
Cool.
Because you don't want to be working with somebody that says they like everything you do. You know what I mean? That, it doesn't really work in a recording situation. No,
doesn't.
Because everything you do isn't great. Everything you do is not always great. So,
no,
yeah,
no. That you wouldn't have a producer, you know, producing your album if everything you did was perfect, would you? They're there to do their magic, aren't they? So.
Well, nobody quite knows what the magic is. That's the great thing about it. But yeah, definitely. You want somebody there to sort of sprinkle the magic dust onto the tracks. Yeah.
So you said that you'd like to tour every single ABC album in its entirety. Sparks did something similar a few years ago where they played a 21-night residency in London, playing a different album every night. Is that the kind of format you might have in mind, or would you like to just do several different tours?
No, definitely not. No, too much like hard work. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know how they did it. I applaud them. I mean, Sparks are incredible, aren't they?
Yeah.
You know, they've got a new album out now. They're fantastic. But me, no. It would be good. There's about, how many albums are there? There's about 9 ABC albums. So, yeah, it would be nice to show up in the outfits from each era. Yeah,
time stamp them with the album.
I'm kind of happy playing. We play like a 2-hour set, and it kind of we take
bits from everything,
various songs from various albums. But some albums get neglected, fair enough, you know. But you love them all, you know.
Yeah.
I love them all. I mean, you know,
no, well, absolutely, they're your babies, so you know,
definitely. Every artist is the same, aren't they? You know, they love all the music.
We understand one of the gold suits was nearly flushed down a toilet in Japan. How many Gold Lamé suits have you gone through over the years?
Over the years, I had 3 originally. One got stolen in Coventry. Yeah, I was at the Kia Plaza Hotel at the end of a long tour, and I had a bag full of souvenirs, so I kind of left it. I was thinking about flushing the suit then. but years later, I went and opened up for Robbie Williams, and I think I got a gold suit made then. William Hunt of Savile Row, my mate, made me a suit. And he said, Martin, it's... You know, you're a little older now. You're playing these stadiums, opening up for Robbie, year 2000. But it's like Star Trek, The Next Generation. You know, you still have to wear the Starfleet uniform.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? On the SS Enterprise. So it's the same in ABC.
Do you get a feel, you know, when you put that gold suit on? Does it take you back to that time?
It's a different suit.
Yeah.
It, you know.
Yeah, yeah. But just that feel. But
I've got a tuxedo, gold tuxedo, sometimes throw that on. I pretend I've just found it in the backstage when I come into it.
Oh, this old
thing. Just special shows, yeah, and it felt right. We'd come on and we'd encore with the Look of Love, and I kind of, yeah, I'd grab it and put it on for that. Yeah, it felt right. It does the show for me, yeah.
So John actually sent in a question about Lexicon of Love too. He'd like to know, how did that whole concept come about?
For years, people would say, well, do you want to follow that record up with, you know, with something? And I was doing a lot of shows with the South Bank Symphonia and with Anne Dudley conducting the orchestra. And it felt right to kind of make a record that was kind of big sounding, you know, a big kind of sounding dramatic record. That kind of was one key factor. And then I looked out into the audience and realized people would really like to hear something that documented what, you know, all the changes we've been through the years. So it felt right to kind of, not to chase something from the past, but to make a new record of new songs, new arrangements, but to give it that air of familiarity. And it felt right with the Lexicon of Love 2, with Viva Love and Flames of Desire, 10 Below Zero, Ship of the Seasick Sailor, various songs. It was to be.
It fits, yeah.
Yeah, and it fitted to do a bit of ABC on steroids, you know. It was kind of a very big sound, bombastic, big sort of glam sound. It felt right.
So your children now are in their 30s. What do they think when they look at your early look, your videos, your early success?
I never ask them, honestly. We don't, you know, we don't sit and flick through the old scrapbooks, I'm afraid. They come to shows occasionally, yeah. But I don't know. They're into their own thing, definitely. Yeah. Mm. I think they're encouraging, but I don't know. You know, we've had some fun through the years going to different shows, though. Yeah, yeah.
So Fran has asked, you do tell a story about when you were having the radiotherapy for the Hodgkin's lymphoma, and record label bosses asked to meet with you. At the time, you felt worried that maybe they were going to drop the band, But as you sat with them, that you recounted that as you were talking to them, a waiter came over and that nervously asked for your autograph, which you felt kind of maybe reestablished your importance. And at that time, you weren't dropped. Did you ever find out who that waiter was?
No, I tell you that it was the best autograph ever. I'd lost a lot of weight. I mean, I had Hodgkin's when I was 27, and I had chemotherapy and radiotherapy up in Sheffield. And the label kept saying, we've got to meet. And I said, well, you know, I'll see you next July, you know what I mean? But they were kind of, I was a racehorse, and they were looking at my teeth, really, seeing if I could still run a few furlongs for them. And they put us on a retainer, you know, But I must say that, like, and I put a big coat on. I put a suit on and a big coat on because I was kind of like a bit, you know, skinny. And I have to say, yeah, that guy, I do remember him. He was so cool. Yeah, he was like, I'd like to thank him.
I hope he knows who he is somewhere. Absolutely.
It was the Hallam Towers Hotel in Sheffield, yeah.
Well, there we
1986,
go.
1986, I think. Yeah.
Fabulous. Something. So a question from Martin, there's been talk for ages of a 40th anniversary edition of the Lexicon of Love. Is this happening? And if so, when?
Yeah, there's an Atmos mix and everything, and they're going to enhanced, and that's coming out in a couple of months' time, I think. Yeah.
Oh, cool.
I was hoping for it to come out last year, but it's the 41st anniversary. Yeah. So, cool. Who's counting? But yeah, that all comes out on Universal, I think, in June, July period. Yeah, soon.
Something to look forward to. Brilliant. You mentioned briefly about the orchestra. John's actually asked, would you be looking to do any more tours with a big, big orchestra?
Yeah, I mean, the touring with the orchestra has gone down really well. There's a lot of demand for it. And we like playing in theatres as opposed to playing a big arena. It's nice for the acoustics to be in a theatre. So inevitably, there's always a few people looking for tickets and they can't get in. So I think we'll play February period. Yeah, probably go out and play with Anne Dudley and the South Bank Symphony with the band. Yeah, that'd be nice.
So Gerard has asked, did you go for a swim whilst filming the video for SOS? So here we are, drifting on an open sea. So here we are. That made me laugh. I mean, that diver guy was incredible, but yeah.
No. And I was kind of, all our videos were kind of shot in Shepherd's Bush or somewhere as dramatic and interesting as that, which isn't very dramatic or interesting. And I was always a bit jealous of Duran Duran because they were always in Sri Lanka or somewhere
exotic.
So, Anthony Price, you know, we were always kind of in a warehouse somewhere. So no, didn't go
in
for
a swimming pool.
Swim a lot now, but not then. Yeah.
So Brenda asked, where did the inspiration for the song Look of Love come from?
Oh, that's such a long time ago. The main part of the inspiration came from that feeling you get when you kind of feel low and you think, I've got to get back in the race, back in the game. And you climb off the canvas if you've kind of had an emotional kicking, you dust yourself down. And it's about going out into the world and finding the look of love somewhere, you know. I think that's a very universal theme. And I think that's why the song's been so popular through the years, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it's public property now, yeah.
And resonates to everyone, really.
That feeling of defiance, of like, you know, we've all been there, of like, no. There's another song we had called Tears Are Not Enough, you know, no. I'm going to face the world. Yeah, I think that's a big part of everybody's experience.
And a great message to give. So Sian asks, the last question, if you could pick one of your songs to have been covered by Bowie, which song would you choose?
Oh, that'd be great.
I think that's an interesting question to finish on.
In fact, if people don't like Bowie, I don't like them. You know
what I mean? Absolutely. I'm with you on that one, all the way.
I met a guy once, I love Steely Dan, and this guy says, okay, I don't understand Steely Dan. I can't see the appeal. Yeah, we should never speak again. You know what I mean? So, it would be great if Bowie had covered The Night You Murdered Love. Yeah.
Ah, yes, that would fit, actually. I could hear that.
Mm. And done a kind of Let's Dance treatment of it, yeah, because we were both chasing the same thing. Let's Dance was a kind of wonderful, with Nile Rodgers. On The Night You Murdered Love, we kind of used as many Nile Rodgers, Bernard Edwards, Chic, mannerisms as we possibly could, because Bernard Edwards was working with us at the time. So The Nightingale Medal of Love, yeah, that would have been great.
Brilliant.
But hey.
Well, Martin, we can't wait to have ABC at Forever Young. We've tried to make it happen. You were scheduled in during the COVID years and that all went. Yeah. But here we are, coming towards July. Ireland is so excited you're going to be joining us. So, ladies and gentlemen, until July, it's the amazing Mr. Martin Fry. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Cheers.
Yeah, cheers.
Bye.
Thanks. Bye there. Of my heart.